Hey folks, and welcome to Drinking Alone with Friends, a podcast where three friends drink alone together. My name's Chris.
What up? It's Tud.
And I'm Obert.
What?
Guys,
Hang on, sorry, that was my 8-track player over here.
DJ Jazzy
in the background.
Jeff.
That was my record player. Sorry. Let me stop scratching this needle.
Yeah, go fix that.
Yeah.
No, the record scratch is because I'm going to jump right into a beer review because I think that it's that important for this episode.
Okay, this is the earliest we've ever gotten to a beer review. Within the first minute, let's go.
This.
I'm ready.
So, my beer this week is to celebrate Untappd's 10-year anniversary.
Oh, cool.
And so, we started with, you know, hashtag Untappd, let's get on this.
Uh-huh.
And I didn't realize that Untappd was this years old.
Yes.
10
years.
Yes. So this beer is called I Remember My First Check-In. And this one is by Skygazer Brewing Company. Much like the Black is Beautiful beers or the Altogether beers or all the other collaborative beers that people have done, this is the same type of style, but Untappd designed this recipe and basically released it to the people and said, make your own edits as needed.
That's kind of cool. I mean,
yeah.
I don't know how much I trust them to make a beer, given the fact they only have a 5-point scale, you know? And
that's true.
And 10 years now. Now they really got to move to a 10-year
scale. I know, right? Scale. Yeah. Maybe that's why they didn't do it. That's the 10-year gimmick.
So what this is, to go into a little bit further, it says Untappd's website has, with Untappd's 10-year anniversary following in unprecedented times, we did what craft beer lovers do best. We expanded our palate and decided to honor the occasion in a whole new way. Together with our friends at Dogfish Head, they are bringing you I Remember My First Check-In, a unique sour beer that celebrates connectivity of the craft beer community. As long-standing sour beer producers, Dogfish Head has created a sour beer base that's been crafted to support the entire craft beer ecosystem. From farmers growing ingredients to artisans brewing beer to favorite local bartenders offering up the perfect pour to Untappd users checking in a new beer for the first time. I Remember My First Check-In as a celebration of where we've been as a craft beer community and where we are going.
So with all that being said, what style is this beer?
So this is, as I pointed out, it is a sour beer, but this one in particular is a Berliner style Weiss beer. And Skygazer then took that recipe and obviously did what Skygazer does best and throws a whole bunch of fruit in it and then a whole bunch of weird stuff in it. So this one is boysenberry, blackberry, cranberry, apple, maple syrup, and vanilla.
Oh, wow.
So all of that stuff is added to, that's Skygazer's additions to the Untappd beer recipe.
Correct. So the Untappd beer recipe, if you go onto their website, you can actually download the recipe. And all it does is it says that it gives them the beer specs, the grain, so it's 2-row and wheat malt, and then fruits and vegetables, fresh and locally sourced, 0 to 20%, and hops, however you like to order, and however you like in order to meet the IBU target. Herbs and spices, let's says let your local freak flag fly, yeast, brewery choice, and sourcing method is a kettle sour with lactic acid producing bacteria. So basically,
so they're really letting people out for the long leash here.
The door is open. It's like, yeah. Brew sour, stamp on it.
Just brew a Berliner Weiss and call it I Remember My First Check-In.
Correct.
Hmm, that's cool.
So parting the kimono a bit here, I had this beer on Saturday.
Oh, okay.
And
what?
I'm going to save my thoughts on it because I don't want to influence Tud.
This exact one from Skygazer?
Not the can that he's holding, but yes, the same beer from Skygazer.
Oh, okay. Oh.
Like it's not just like a sneaky empty can that I stuck in his house to check the beer.
This tastes like water.
Did you go to the brewery or did somebody else have it?
No, this was, you know, infamous friend of the podcast, Larissa, was picked this one up and she was kind enough to share it with me.
Gotcha. Okay. So now we'll have two people. Chris, I don't know what you're doing, but you gotta hashtag get on this and, you know, find this beer down there.
I'm so far away. You guys are gonna have to send it to me.
I'm sure other breweries have brewed this beer. Not this exact one, but something like it.
No, probably not.
Yeah, you don't live, you know, only a couple hours away from probably one of the best sour breweries on the planet or nothing.
No, I don't. No, that's a pretty cool thing. You know, it's funny. I was on Untappd and I saw a bunch of, like, I remember my first check-ins and I wasn't sure what was happening. I was like, what is this, like a weird thing that you can like go back and like see your, I don't know what I thought it was, but now that makes a lot more sense.
Hang on one second.
It's raining like a bastard here.
Okay. Yeah,
it like just picked up like a minute ago and it's like thundering bad. So yeah, unfortunately I have everything turned down as much as I can right now. But
so listeners, just so you know, you could hear how bad it's raining at Chris's house.
Right. I will try to edit it out, but
the skies were angry that day, my friends.
Update, he's putting buckets around the living room.
Hold on. Let me get I need to go out to the shed real quick. CJ's got a little blow-up canoe that I can get into. So I'm currently floating. Thankfully, I got a wireless mic.
Wireless computer.
Wireless computer. Yeah,
wireless computer. Wireless internet.
Well, I do have wireless internet. That's one thing I do have.
No wireless fridge, though. That could be a problem.
Ooh, I know. Yeah. I'm going to have to dive down to get my beers.
Dive deep and finish your drink.
That's right.
All right. So jumping into this beer, as you guys can see, that is a maroon beer.
Yeah. Nice. Nice looking.
Oh, but clearly you know the color already.
Yeah. I love that omnipolar glass.
This has become one of my new favorite glasses. It's just fantastic. But yeah, it is like super maroon. Had a nice little head that kind of dissipated rather quickly, but still kind of lingering a little bit. Whew. The smells that I smelled, Jenna.
Smelted, I think, is the
proper word. Yeah, you smelted.
Yeah, I'm not allowed to say smelted anymore. I got lambasted about that today, apparently.
You smelted the aroma into a sense. That's what it was.
Yes, I smelt the fish into a smell of a beer.
There you go. I thought it was pretty clear.
I smell a lot of fruit, and I definitely smell maple syrup. I'm not getting any particular fruits. I just smell berries. So I'm just going to leave that up to the blackberry, boysenberry, and cranberries that I'm smelling. And definitely maple syrup. I don't smell any vanilla. By the way, listeners, this is a can, and it's 5.5 ABV, and it was canned relatively not that long ago. 11/4/2020.
Oh, that's a week old.
Yeah. So let's dive into the nose or the mouth flavors. There's a lot going on here. Oh, wow. Literally so much going on. Up front, you get a lot of the berry flavor. It immediately goes to sour, and like more sour than you would expect from a Berliner Weiss. Mm. You guys had some of the other Skygazers that I had when you guys were at my house brewing beer. Their Berliner Weisses tended to be a lot more fruit forward and not really sour. Mm. This is a lot more sour. I would probably
say you get like a tart pucker, maybe.
Yeah, I would say like a 7, like a sour Granny Smith apple.
Yep.
Okay. Approaching the warhead levels.
Yeah, approaching warhead levels. I mean, this is good. But then that sourness quickly, like almost as soon as it hits your tongue, fades into maple syrup. I mean, just straight up maple syrup induced pancake, just right there on your tongue. I mean, it's delicious. I mean, it's a very weird, freaky kind of switch, but I don't mind it. You know, it doesn't leave your mouth coated with like that maple, like if you drank maple syrup, like what your mouth would feel like afterwards. It, you know, the maple syrup kind of lingers, the flavor does, but your mouth doesn't feel like it's coated in syrup.
Right. You get some of the sweetness, but not super thick, right?
Yeah, you get a lot more like the back end of the maple, like if you had like a buttery maple syrup, like you get a lot of that like buttery flavor afterwards, that buttery syrup.
So I know you said you didn't get vanilla on the nose. Do you get any in the flavor profile?
None. Let me pour the rest of the can and see if maybe the vanilla sunk to the bottom.
That was one thing I did notice, is that as I drank the flavor profile, as things settled out, I got more and more fruit bits towards the bottom of the can.
Bottom of the can was definitely thicker with two C's than the top of the can. I probably should have twisted the can around a little bit before I poured it.
Right.
It's a lot less sour now, which is interesting with the bottom of the can in there. I still don't get any vanilla, though. It's not my favorite Skygazer beer that I've had, but it's a very good beer. I'm happy that I have it because it's extremely unique, and I don't think I'll ever taste another beer quite like this again.
Right.
It's a solid drinking beer. I'm going to give this... I think it's unique enough to be a 4.25. I think this is... It's very good. It's got that unique flavor that I really don't... I really actually like that maple syrup back end. If more beers that said maple syrup could capture what this has on the back end, I would like maple syrup. I think maple syrup beers would be higher up on the echelon of, like, bourbon barrel-aged things. It'd be, oh, maple syrup barrel-aged if they could get this type of flavor out of it.
Now, I mean, there's a few that do the maple syrup very, very well. But
The CBS right?
comes to mind right away. But
CBS, yeah. So the way the CBS is,
yeah.
That's how this is. Okay. It's very, it's mild but there. It's mild but punching you in the face, I guess, if that makes sense.
Actually,
like a baby took its fist to your face.
The defensive pancake was also maple syrup. That was very good, too.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
So,
like, Chris, imagine if, like, Luke punched you in the face. That's what the maple syrup flavor is like.
He's a stout young man, so he probably can react or something and knock another baby out for sure. cool. That's awesome. I'm going to have to look up one, because now you both have had this one.
So my rating was also 4.25.
Well, I was going to say, really? I didn't know if you wanted to give Tud a little bit more ammunition for the man of the people, you know?
Oh, well, I did not check it in.
Okay.
Anticipating in a Tud Cleo-like moment that Tud is going to... No. Yeah, I thought that I liked the boysenberry. I liked the cranberry. Very much tart. I got more vanilla than Tud did.
Yeah, I got none.
It was Saturday here. It was like, I don't know, mid-70s, and I was sitting in the sun. And the beer warmed up quite a bit. And as I warmed up, I got more vanilla.
Mm.
It was a perfect porch day beer, for sure.
I can definitely see, especially if it's cold, I can see the sweetness from the maple syrup and the sweetness from the vanilla blending. So, you know, maybe the warmer it gets. Tud, you might have to report back as it gets warmer.
It has been, like, unseasonably warm in Connecticut. And it is hot in this house right now. So I would imagine that this beer is going to heat up quite well over the next hour or so. but yeah, I'll push my beer to the side and leave it there to see if I get any more flavors.
Nice. So I have it pulled up. I have the correct one pulled up on Untappd. So out of 173 check-ins, one of which is not Obert's, what do you think the Untappdiverse thinks of the Skygazer Brewing's version of I Remember My First Check-In?
Well, I will tell you this, Skygazer is very well thought of in this state. It does have that hashtag hop hype without really doing IPAs as well as other breweries. I guess it has that hashtag like Berliner hype. I'm going to say it's pretty high. I will say 4.37.
Okay, no, not that high.
Okay.
It's formidable. It's high. It's not that high, though. 4.13. So,
oh wow, I was off.
Yeah, you were a bit off. I have three friends checked it in. Tyler from the other beer podcast in Connecticut, 1056 podcast, gave it a 3.75. So, just proves something.
Proves it is a beer.
Proves it's a beer. No,
Ted did not just invent this.
No, but so he gave it 3.75, 4, and then a 4.3 because he is the real Untappd. He has paid Untappd.
Untappd got on it on his.
That's cool. I'm gonna have to look up. I'm gonna have to do some research and see who does it around me. I assume Resin Cultured Vibe Barrel. Someone has to have this. I just haven't seen it yet. So that's cool. I like that. I like that idea.
Yeah,
we need our own. We need our own beer. We need a DAWF podcast beer.
We already brewed it.
No, but like one that worse brewers could make, like, you know, like.
Oh, like we need a recipe.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, okay, so here's our recipes. So all we have to do is figure out like, just like, it sounds like all we need to do is figure out a style, a general kind of a malt to use and a general kind of a yeast to use and then let people go hog wild.
No, yeah.
You call the yeast brewer's choice.
Yeah.
You know.
So we can say any beer is just.
Yeah. We're just going to go malt profile, brewer's choice. Yeast profile, brewer's choice. Fruit content, brewer's choice. Additions, brewer's choice.
Just
final OG and final OG and readings and all that stuff and IBUs, brewer's choice.
There you go. Yeah, so if there's any breweries out there that want to make the official beer of DAWF Podcast, or more of you can do it, you know.
It sounds like I can go to my kitchen sink and pour myself a glass of DAWF beer right now. Legally, it'll be considered our beer.
Yeah, that would be awesome. I don't know, maybe, you know, sponsor the podcast, unofficial sponsor the podcast.
Water?
Water, no, Labyrinth Brewing Company, you know, official brewery sponsor the podcast. They can make us a beer. So, brewers out there,
it's true.
Make a beer and name it, I don't know what we'd call, the Frosty Mug of Wisdom or something.
No, you're missing this here. Brewer's choice of what they name it.
So
the name has to be called Brewer's Choice, though.
Okay, okay.
No. They get to choose it. It's their name.
Oh, so actually, it's funny you say that because I think my beer might be a tribute to us. I get it. I get it now.
Yeah. So you guys got to go a little bit higher.
Ted, if there's a way you could patent this, we could make a lot of money.
Yeah.
It's true.
This patent beer.
This patent just says beer on it. Yeah. Yeah, we figured we'd try to get it.
Yeah, we just label all the things Brewer's Choice, and we figured we're good.
Well, at least I know what the name of the episode is.
It's so nice when they're easy. Oh, man.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, enjoy your DAWF Podcast official beer, which is whatever you're drinking right now, because it probably was made in tribute to us.
Right. As we just discovered that every beer is brewed as a tribute to us, including this, I remember my first check-in beer. So with that, I'm done, and I'm going to hand it over to Chris.
My beer's getting cold. Warm, no, room cold.
Beer 30 was 5 minutes ago, and his beer's getting warm.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Shit. Hang on. But we got the record scratch for mine. We didn't get no cool music. So with that, hit it, DJ. Beer
30, and I'm thirsty. I've been working like a dog all week long, so maybe something cold won't hurt me. Because it's beer 30, and it's time to party.
Yeah, baby. All right. It's beer 30. I'm thirsty. And I am bringing to the podcast a gift from fellow co-host Tud.
Woo!
And this is Back East Brewing Company, one of the podcast favorites.
I was there today.
Oh, there you go. So
nice.
And this is their Double Scoop, a Citra Double IPA. They are known for their Ice Cream Man, which is like their flagship. That's what everybody knows them by. As well as
number 5 IPA in the country.
Yeah. And as well as a bunch of amazing beers. Back East makes really good stuff. And yeah, so I'm pretty excited about this. I don't think I've had this before. If I have, it was drunkenly at a beer fest. So, you know, that's the only way I think I would have had this.
That happens a lot.
Yeah, it does happen more than it should, probably. Man, I miss beer fests. Why can't NFL-CBA ruining America. So, yeah, we're going to jump into this thing. I'm pretty excited for it. Ice Cream Man was really good. We almost went to a party with a keg of Ice Cream Man once.
Good story.
Yep.
Wait, when was this?
It was your friend at the after the Rising Pint. Your friend was like, he's got that? A keg of Ice Cream Man. And then
we ended
up not going. I don't remember what happened.
Yeah, because, you want to know what happened? We were drunk.
Oh, that doesn't sound like us.
After a beer fest?
Yes, how silly.
I don't know about that. That doesn't really add up.
It doesn't sound like looking back on it now, us being drunk from a beer festival and then going to somebody's house with a keg of Ice Cream Man doesn't sound like the makings of a good next day.
No, but I mean, this was also the same beer fest that we pre-gamed. We
did that.
We were just like, I don't know. We're very smart.
You know what goes well with as much beer as you could possibly drink for one set price? Pre-gaming.
Yes. That, and then we ordered $200 worth of pizza afterwards,
yep,
too.
Yep, $200 worth of pizza, and they all had pepperoni on it. Oh my god, it was so funny.
Oh, yeah. Me screaming across the apartment, I wanted one pizza without pepperoni. And instead, we got pizza with all pepperoni. Every pizza. Whether it be, you know, the pepperoni had more pepperoni, the other meat had pepperoni, the vegetables had pepperoni. I think even, like, the cheesy breadsticks had pepperoni.
Oh,
like, it was just literally pepperoni extravaganza.
It was so funny, and I remember, like, just being, just dying, Tud's drunk on the couch. And like, he's so mad about all the pepperoni. I'm dying. Obert's dying. Caitlin's dying. Like, it's just the funniest. To this day, like, so it's my probably my favorite pizza related story.
And you have a lot of
I
them.
Do. I have quite a few, but Jesus, that was so funny. So adamant. And I heard her order. She didn't order everything with pepperoni, but someone at the pizza restaurant was like, fuck that dude in the background.
Yeah. Yeah. He's being way too loud. Pepperoni on everything.
Yeah, right? So funny. Oh, God.
Oh, man.
I don't remember any of that because I was probably just sitting there eating a piece of pepperoni pizza being like, this is exactly what I wanted to eat right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, pepperoni pizza is great. It's right up there with, like, McDonald's when you're drunk. Anyways, so into into the double scoop, a nice hazy boy, very orange, can't really see through it. The head dissipated, but there's a nice little rim of head there. Some nice lacing going on. And, yeah, I'm pretty excited.
Ooh, that's a good term.
I'm getting smart.
It's almost like you're...
Someone's been doing their research.
Yeah, almost like you work on, like, a beer podcast or something.
Wicked smart. Yeah. So the smell taste is pretty heavy on like a citrusy kind of thing. I mean, it's a Citra IPA, so of course you're going to get a lot of those smells. I can't really pick anything out though. It kind of smells like a Julius Tastes. Is that weird? Like, it smells like a Julius Tastes, but it doesn't smell like a Julius. So,
okay, you had me until you said that last part.
No, cuz it smells different. I don't think I can explain it any better than that. So let's see what it tastes like. It doesn't taste like ice cream. I'll say that.
I don't know if you'd want your Citra IPA to taste like ice cream. I just
maybe a sherbet.
Something tells me that if you got a Citra IPA and it tasted like vanilla and or chocolate and or strawberry ice cream, you'd be like, I don't like this.
This is pretty good. I definitely get it's kind of bitter. You know, I get kind of a lot of bitterness in it, which I don't mind, of course. And then, I mean, I'm picking out a decent amount of, like, pineapple. Is that weird? Like, I don't know why that's the one that comes forward, but that's the one that is. And then it does kind of taste a little bit like a Julius. So, I haven't had Julius in a good long time, but, the Julius that I remember, I guess this...
Does it taste at all like Ice Cream Man?
I haven't. See, that's the other thing. I haven't had an ice cream man in like 3 years. So,
well, you know how to you know how to rectify that situation.
I know. I have one somewhere, either over there or in the fridge. I don't remember.
This is starting to become your signature move, Chris.
What? Just yeah. Drinking multiple things?
Well, you have to. You have to try the whole flavor game.
Well, now it's gonna be. I should have went the other way around then. But I was like, right. I haven't had this one. I was excited by it. So, Okay, this is. I like Citra hops, but I think Citra hops alone, not my favorite. I think I'm coming down to learn this. Because, I don't know, this is a really good beer, and you can tell it's made very well. But, like, I don't know, I feel like I'm missing, like, a mosaic or something like that to, like, balance it out a little
balance
bit.
Balance it out.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know what usually not mix with the Citra hop, now that I'm sitting here and thinking about it, because I was wondering, oh, what would I like to mix the Citra hop with, is Galaxy. Very rarely do you find an IPA that's both Galaxy and Citra.
No, yeah, I can't think of one off the top of my head. I'm sure there are some.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure there are some, but those are like the two of like the big like five hops that they never really mix.
No, I mean, it's always like Citra Mosaic. Like, it's those are like tied at the hip almost. So yeah. I don't know, I think like I'm just starting to realize, like, I think I need a little bit more of the like the pininess, earthiness to like mellow out some of the sweetness from like a Citra. Then again, not a bad beer at all, very very good, but just I think this is a revelation that I'm having on the podcast about my taste in beer. So it's good. Definitely not my favorite double IPA. It is 8.4% alcohol, so contains no dairy. Thank you, Cam, for letting me know that. But back east, I mean, they do amazing stuff. We talk about them a number of times. Man, I feel bad. I feel like I'm going to give this a low rating, and I don't think it deserves it. But I'm going to give this a 3.75 on Untappd. It's good, but like I said, I think it's just more of a personal issue than it's not you, it's me. You know, it's one of those things. And I think I gave Ice Cream Man more than that. I don't know. Now, damn it, now I really want to try Ice Cream Man.
So my first time having the double scoop was also after Tud gave it to me. And I felt the same way. I like Ice Cream Man a lot better. But normally, if there's like a double IPA variant on a very popular single IPA, I like the original better. I feel like, you know, back at that infamous pepperoni night, we had Triple Sunshine for the first time.
That's true.
And I was like underwhelmed. I was like, it was just too much. I felt the same way about this, where just like, maybe you just can't beat that classic Ice Cream Man flavor.
Yeah. Yeah, I could definitely see that. Yeah. I'm glad I'm not the only one, by the way. I'm like sitting here. I'm like, oh no, Back East is going to hear about this and they're not going to make any more DAWF podcast beers. But yeah, no, I mean, I think that's always a thing, you know, and I think it also kind of helps which one comes first. Like if they make the single first, you know, I don't know, at least to me, when I have, and they're not quite the same, but like, G-Bot and Baby Bot, are those the two?
Yeah.
But Baby Bot's not, is that a single or is that a,
yes,
or is that a session? I don't remember. Anywho, G-Bot's way better. So like, I don't know. I think it's like whatever one I've had more nostalgia, et cetera, et cetera. So,
Baby Bot is a session.
It is a session. So that's a little different, but anywho, that's what I mean. So, okay.
By the way, how great is it that like Ice Cream Man now is like readily available at Back East? Like you just go there and be like, I want it on tap. I want to bring some home. And they're like, yeah, sure. Have Ice Cream Man.
No, I'm like in the, we've been gone for what, 3 years, almost 3 years. And like, just in that time, being able to walk into a grocery store and getting like, I mean, there were hundreds of beers in a big Y, like not even like a specialty beer store. Just like, now granted, I bet you that's like an upper echelon of the big Y's, but still, it's like, you just walk into the local grocery store and you can get beer and all this stuff that you couldn't get anywhere but the brewery.
Wandering in the fog.
Yeah, wandering in the fog.
Sitting on the shelf.
Yeah, and like,
you know, I heard a report from enemy of the pod, Blevin, today.
Okay. Oh,
and he went looking for Wandering in the Fog, per advice from one particular co-host, and he couldn't find it. So maybe he went to the wrong Big Y.
Well, he's Blevin. He probably just did it wrong.
Yeah, or they saw him. Probably. They saw him coming. They heard him coming.
They took it all away.
Because when he walks,
like, he probably walked to like the meat section and tried to buy it instead of like steaks. And didn't walk to the beer section, and that's why I didn't find it.
Yeah, my least favorite part about Blevin is he just has to scream at the top of his lungs, "Blevin's here! Blevin's here!" Wherever he goes.
Anytime he walks into a building.
So they probably heard that, and they're like, "Wait a minute, we got to hide all the DAWF podcast beer," and then they hit it all. So, oh man, he's the worst. oh man. So let me see. Untappd. I'm sure this is going to be super high, over 1,000 million check-ins, because Back East does that. Actually, how long have they been brewing this, Tud? For a while now?
I think so. I mean, I don't have the actual like day it was first brewed.
Oh.
But there are 4,368 check-ins.
Okay, so that's high. That's about what I figured is going to be pretty high. Okay, I'm going to think it's probably going to be like a 4.17.
No.
Play the noise. Oh.
It is a 4.30.
Damn. Okay. Okay. I was like in my mind 4.22, but then I said 4.17 because I don't know why.
Interesting. Like your guesses were kind of swapped for the beers.
I know, right? Yeah.
Damn. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. 4.30. I am definitely not the person to ask about this, but anywho, thank you, Tud, for this.
Because you're welcome.
As well as all the other beer. I have so much beer, you guys. It's awesome. I have so much beer. It's funny. Like, I have so much beer, but yeah.
It's a good problem to have.
It's a good problem to have, yes. But I'm still like, could have more beer. Like, that's where it stops.
No, I think I should advise you, as the person of this podcast who almost has a full kitchen of beer, don't go down that rabbit hole. Get rid of the beer you have. I will say that you guys greatly helped me get rid of a lot of my beer. So I have a lot less beer. Like, you know, you guys each probably gave me about a case, if not a little bit more each. And I only have 3-4 packs that are not currently in a fridge.
Wow.
Which is great. That's how much beer we got rid of.
That's impressive.
Those 2 days.
That's impressive. Yeah.
And that's keeping the aperitif fridge beer free.
That's, yeah, the aperitif fridge is full of aperitif, obviously. You can't stick anything else in it.
Right.
It's
the downfall is that my kegerator fridge still has beer in it, and we have beer in the basement that needs to be kegged.
That's going to be a bit of a...
It sounds like you're the one who should be reviewing the ice cream man tonight.
That's true. I think I got rid of it all, though. I think I gave it to you guys as a, here's some beer.
Yeah, I've been slowly drinking through, well, depending on how the streams have been going, either slowly or very quickly going through some of these beers. And the one thing, and I said it as soon as I bought it, but I'm like, I wish I had more Fox Farm. That's the one brewery I wish I had more of.
It's very good.
Yeah. Yeah, man, it's so good. It's so good.
Well, one good thing about this pandemic that's seeming to come out of it is nowadays I feel like every time I bring a beer out, everybody has their own cups and I pour a little bit into. So I feel like you go through beers a lot faster as opposed to like being like, oh, hey, take a sip of this, take a sip of that. Like now it's easy to divvy up a beer because everybody has their own glasses.
True.
I've been, since being back in Connecticut, hang out with people, socially distancing, drinking outside. It's like, oh, the 16 ounce can split four ways. It's, just a couple sips and then you're ready to try the next beer. So, one way to look, silver lining to look at,
Yeah. Like I said, when we brewed beer, I mean, we probably drank through, at least a few four packs, but it was, at splitting it four ways and then five ways when Caitlin got home, it was like nothing. It was like, oh, here's two sips of a beer. All right. Time for the next one.
Yeah. It's like going to a brewery or tap room and getting a bunch of samplers. Yeah.
Okay. So that is my review. So last, certainly not least, is Obert.
What if somebody announced them like last and least?
Last and least, here comes Obert. Ready to review a beer that we all know is the least beer.
The least beer of all the beers.
But it's still a DAWF podcast tribute beer.
That is true.
All right.
Okay, so I have a beer I'm very excited about. This is the first beer I ever bought in a two-pack of cans before.
Ooh.
Yeah, I actually split this with frequent letter writer Sal. He was like...
Sal the pal.
I don't want to spend, I think it was $16 or $18 on a two-pack. Anybody want to split it with me? So this might be the most expensive can of beer I've ever bought. But I'm excited for it. I know nothing about it. It's called Orin, O-R-I-N,
okay.
And it's from Half Acre Beer Company, which is out of Chicago, Illinois. And I've heard really good things about Half Acre, but that's all I've heard is like, they're really good. It's got this funky elemental pyramid with kind of wavy lines all around the can. Let's see. I should also mention, smells very strange. It's brewed.
It's always what you want to hear when somebody sniffs a beer. Smells strange.
This is a all it says here describing the beer is it's a bourbon and brandy barrel aged beer. Two things I would not really put together.
Very interesting, yeah.
It is, Untappd describes it as a strong ale.
Okay, yeah. I get like a little bit of those barley wine notes on the nose. I'm pouring this into Lord Hobo brewing glasses. Do they exist anymore?
Yeah. Nice. Yeah, they do. I haven't heard about them. They still do Boom Sauce and Glorious and the other one there.
I haven't heard about them in a long time.
Yeah, I literally have not had one of those beers in such a long time. And I remember loving them a long time ago.
So to Tud's point, this does weigh in at 12.3% ABV.
Woof.
So I'm glad we saved it for last. But yeah, so strong ale for sure.
Surprised you're not drunk just sniffing it.
I know. So, yeah, let me go back to those interesting smell tastes here. I definitely get very strong oak aroma, more so than the brandy or the bourbon even, just like the wood barrel.
Like a wood chuck?
Maybe a wood chip.
Ooh.
Pouring it, it's not quite a billion SRM, but it's definitely a deep brown color. Mm. We're talking upper 30s here.
Yeah.
And it didn't have a head either. So all three of the beers tonight didn't really have
really quick.
Yeah. Interesting. Breweries, I got to tell you, I like having a little bit of head on my beer. So hashtag, let's get on that.
You like get caught in the mustache.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. I'm really struggling to describe this aroma. So without further ado, I got to jump right into this, see what it tastes like. That's very complex on the palate. You get a lot of those super sweet fermented, maybe not super sweet, super fermented sweet flavors of like that golden raisin. Those rich caramel notes. I think with a beer this rich, yeah, maybe some elements of toffee a little bit. Just really sweet. I can even see a little Tootsie Roll, perhaps. Some Tootsie Roll flavor in here.
Tootsie Roll.
I can taste the 12.5%. And it's not a stout that's super thick. You know, it's an ale that reminiscent of a strong barley wine in a way. It's good. Feel the taste the alcohol. Not a strong burn like I would expect from both the bourbon and the brandy. But I think as I take a little break and kind of breathe in, I get more of that burn. And as it warms up, I think it's starting to get a little bit more. Pretty solid beer. I could say right away, though, that I don't think it was worth, whatever, $8 or $9 a can. But it's tasty. Not a ton of stuff going on. Like, there's no real adjunct flavors in here of, you know, maple syrup or other flavorings. It's just a strong ale. And sometimes that's what you need. Were either of you able to find out information about Half Acre or Orin?
Yeah, so I pulled up some information about the beer itself. Orin 2020 is brewed differently than any other previous batch of Orin. With an eye towards complexity and nuance, this year's Orin was comprised of a blend of 2019 and 2020 vintages aged in various spirit barrels, unnamed bourbon barrels, VSOP brandy barrels, and then Heaven Hill bourbon barrels.
Okay.
Nice.
And pop quiz, Tud, what does VSOP stand for?
Oh, very special old pale. That's right. Very superior old pale. Sorry. Very superior old pale. There you go. So that's nice. That's middle of the road. It's a middle of the road bourbon barrel. Same thing, or brandy barrel. Same thing as Heaven Hill. You know, I wouldn't call Heaven Hill's bourbon the best bourbon, but I would call it a VSOP bourbon, if that makes sense.
Yeah. And I don't know how much. I don't think necessarily the tastiest bourbon would give you the best barrel for aging beer in necessarily either. So who knows how those two correlate. As it's warming up, yeah, it just tastes kind of like a stereotypical, like it's a strong ale, barley wine. You know, there's not a lot of other things I'm pulling out of it. And that's kind of disappointing that I can't go into those details. But
they do. So I knew Half Acre sounded familiar on some level. They do Daisy Cutter Pale Ale. That's like their like flagship.
Okay. I don't think I've seen that before.
Yeah, it sounds familiar, but I don't think I've had it. Half Acre does sound... I've heard of Half Acre, no? Too.
Yeah, I thought it sounded familiar, and I know it because of that beer.
I'm not gonna lie, I'm a little underwhelmed for you, because it sounds like you should be getting a lot more than what you are. Or agreed. I don't know.
I had high hopes.
Yeah, especially and for $9.
Maybe because of like I said, there's a little bit of mystery about not really any description on the can. You know, was there more tasting notes in there, Tud, that you got for me, or
I got vanilla, toffee, which you mentioned, and then with a
did
slightly,
they mention the Tootsie Roll?
It did not mention Tootsie Roll. With a slightly tannic finish. And yeah. I don't know what tannic tastes like.
I think that might be reminiscent of like that oak that I was talking about, but that's a shot
like,
in the dark.
Like oak tannins? So, yeah, that would make sense.
Yeah, yeah. So in a vacuum, blind taste testing, I would probably rate this higher than I would knowing, you know, what I paid for it and the reputation of this brewery. My expectations were not quite met versus if it was just like, hey, this is a homebrew. Try this. I'd be like, wow, that was amazing.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So this is going to be 3.75 for me.
And now, what would you rate it if it was a homebrew?
If this was a Tud creation, if this was a DAWF tribute beer.
Yeah. If you didn't spend $9 on this can, what would you pay or what would you have rated it?
Probably more like 4.1. 4.2. Okay. I wanted to say between 4 and 4.25.
Okay.
Yeah. And regarding the Untappd-iverse.
Yeah, there's 6,960 check-ins.
We need 9 more check-ins.
The 2020 variant?
Yes, this is the 2020 variant.
I think they're gonna like it because they're a bunch of suckers. They're not gonna love it. So they're giving this like a 4.12.
Close.
I was like real close.
Tud, every time you sell it so well. I know. Every time you look at your phone, you look up and you're like, no.
Play the music. Hit the music. Yeah.
4.16.
Damn. Okay.
Honk, 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 honk.
That's right. Man of the people. Damn. Okay. Wow. That was close. Hell close.
Yeah. That was good.
It's very good. Yeah. It's awesome.
Unfortunately, the beer didn't live up to my guessing skills, but
I need to get a sound effect for when like you're wrong. Like, should it be?
Nope.
I think you've definitely dropped that on us before. You've definitely dropped the nope. Yeah.
Can you do when you spin the wheel and it lands on bankrupt?
I don't know.
I'm sure you have that at your command, right?
Right.
Or you could do like Price is Right. Wrong. Yeah. Oh, there we go.
That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah. There we are.
Yeah.
All right.
I feel like of the nature of the number guessing game, Price is Right Wrong is pretty good.
All
right.
From now on, this is going to be our no sound.
So I don't know about you guys. Like, we all know 2020 sucks for like literally every reason possible. Global pandemic, people dying.
You don't have to list them.
Okay. Let's start. January 1st.
Yeah, we'd be here forever.
Like Australia wildfires. January 2nd.
No. Still more wildfires. But like, I don't know.
Hang on. Did you guys see that Halloween costume of, it was like the most tragic Halloween costume of a couple dressed up excitedly celebrating like New Year's with like 2020 glasses. It was a really good costume.
That's a pretty good costume.
Pretty good, horror costume.
That's funny.
Because people do not know what they're in for. Oh my anyway. God,
so bad. So anyways, worst year of all time, probably. Don't look that up. But like, on top of all of that, I have noticed that my beer check-ins are like at a low that they haven't been at in years and years and years. I don't know about you guys. You know, normally I'm 500-600 check-ins a year, and like I'm gonna like right now I'm at 275, and we're almost done. Like, I mean, we're talking like
yeah, you got it. Not even gonna get to 365.
No, here. I know. It's bad, and like I don't know, stupid year, so dumb. Breweries being closed.
You know, what you should do to if you wanted to drink more beers, you should start a streaming account on Twitch where you drink beer and play video games.
That sounds like a really good idea.
That's a good idea, actually. I should probably do that. yeah, no, I don't know what it is. I mean, some of it is the fact that I forget, but like not 300 beers worth.
Yeah. We talked about all the beer fest that we can't go to. That's an easy way to knock out a lot of check-ins.
That is true. Beer fest or like flights. I don't get flights anymore.
Because restaurants aren't a thing. Yeah.
Well, I mean, and we have 1,000 kids, so it's impossible to get a booth.
That I'm sure is part of the reason that you have fewer check-ins too.
Maybe. I'd like to think that I would have to drink twice as much now to make up for all the children.
Now, with as many children as you have, do you ever just lose a few of them?
Children or beer?
Children.
Oh, either.
Either. Yeah. Definitely. Definitely children. Beer, I keep a closer eye on. Like, I try not to lose them as much. Children, they're just crawling all over each other. Who knows what's where? Like, man, kids. you know, it's one of those things.
Sometimes, if you're not careful, you put it down. If you put them down on their side, they might roll away. You know. So you got to be careful. Look under the couch.
Yep.
You don't know.
Yep. You find children everywhere.
Don't shake them.
Nope.
Right.
Either
don't
one.
Shake them.
Beers or children.
Yeah. Don't let them get too hot. Don't let them get too.
Don't put them in the freezer.
Cold. Yeah. Don't put them in the freezer.
Are children just beers?
Maybe.
Until the whole, you know, crack their head open and drink them.
Maybe they're just Brewer's Choice beers.
They're all tributes to our podcast. Every child, every child is a tribute to our podcast. Oh man. Yeah, no, okay. So maybe it's more than just 2020. And I will say 2020 has been terrible except for Lucas. He's the only good thing so far. He's awesome.
I like how you had to preface that.
No, well, when Alex Trebek obviously passed away just last week.
R.I.P. Alex.
Yeah, and
we'll miss you.
And of course, what, 2 weeks earlier, Sean Connery. So
same week.
Wait,
same
Sean
week.
Connery died.
Yeah, you guys. Oh yeah,
it was the same week.
How did I
it
miss
was just
that?
4 days earlier.
Oh, was it? Was it the same week? Shit.
Yeah.
2020
I'm literally
like
finding
forever.
Out right now.
Yeah, no, Sean Connery.
Was it like election day or something, and that's why I missed the news? Or like,
I don't know, the election things, whatever, voter fraud, etc. But like, no, yeah, it was. I guess last week too, like just 4 days earlier.
That's crazy. I need to go watch The Rock right now in tribute.
Yeah, I know.
Sorry, I gotta go.
Sean Connery passed away on Halloween.
Okay. And then Alex Trebek. Okay. Not that long.
So within the same week, I mean.
Yeah. And of course, I posted on the book one of the infamous Celebrity Jeopardies with Alex Trebek and Sean Connery. So good. But yeah, no, it's just been crappy. It's been a crappy year. I don't know. So, but Lucas is also cool. So he's A-okay.
So, Todd, we heard about Chris's lackluster check-in total. How are you doing this year?
I'm at 388.
Okay. All right. So even that, that's low. I feel like that's low.
That is low.
Because normally you're 600, 700, something like that.
Yeah. I mean, between me and Todd, we have just over 400 check-ins, which is really...
That's pretty abysmal if you think about 200 apiece.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, I really got to step up my game.
Yeah. But anyways, hopefully there's no COVID-20, and hopefully that we can get back to it. We can open up all the breweries next year, and CJ can
That's
watch
the goal.
Luke. The kid thing doesn't go away. They don't go away, which is good because they're awesome. But
serious question: at what age is it acceptable to brew a beer with your children?
Now,
five.
You're saying now is in like the year is 2020. We can now brew beer with our children.
Yeah.
Okay.
Any child.
How old do they have to be? Any child. Because we did brew a beer with a child last week.
That is true.
2 weeks ago.
We did that.
Yep.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if we really brewed it with him. He was kind of...
he was there while it was brewed.
He was doing work in the backyard.
Yeah.
I don't think you're allowed to admit that.
Listen, I didn't ask him to do the work. That was his dad.
Hey. It's just unpaid child labor, Chris.
Oh, I guess when you put it that way, it's no big deal. Yeah, you're right.
I gave him pizza.
He's just paying him with food. You know, what more do you want?
Exactly.
Food so he could live.
Obviously. Obvo.
No, but that could be a fun hobby. It's chemistry. It's biology.
It's like baking.
Teach your kids how to brew beer. You know, this is maybe something
that
can
make
in your
beer
future, Chris.
To tribute to us.
You know, you got to set them up on a path in life where they become successful brewers, and you retire and you just serve as a barkeep in their brewery, serving beers while they do all the hard work of brewing.
Ooh, see?
That's pretty smart. Think about it.
Don't. And you got to get in before Dana makes them winemakers.
Porque no las dos.
That's true. You could have rival brothers.
Oh,
one
there we go.
Beer.
Yes.
I smell a sitcom here.
This 5-year-old makes beer. This 3-year-old makes wine.
And when they get together.
Will they win their parents' love? Find out next week on A Brewtiful Vineyard. I don't know. It's the best I got.
This week on Sibling Proof.
That's a good one.
Okay, so with that, I think it's time. We go into our freezer. We take out that weird mug that doesn't really fit because it has three handles on it. And we fill it with life advice, wisdom, products, books, Amazon things.
Books?
Apps? Air?
Apps? Folders? Air? We got it all.
Shiny breeding.
We got it all in this folder, folks. We got it all in this mug.
You want to know how to hunt Pokemon in an obscure Pokemon game? It's in there.
We got it. It's in the mug.
It's in the box.
It's like a cast iron where, like, the more you use it, it gets seasoned with all the flavors.
Yeah.
There you go.
It's just every time we wash out the mug, we really, there's a little bit left from all of our handles. So
that's why I put it in the freezer.
Ah.
We got a thing to do. Hit it, Pete. Hit it, Jordan.
Oh.
Test your handle.
Remix.
Test your handle. Test your handle. Test your handle.
Mug of wisdom!
Drink.
Mug of wisdom!
Finish that bravado.
Thank you, Jordan. Sometimes I forget how good the full version is.
It is good to hear it every once in a while. Yeah.
It is good. Yeah. Thank you as always, Wreck My Podcast. So this week, as honk honk honk, man of the people, honk honk honk, I'm claiming the mug for myself.
Ooh. He wants to receive in the first half.
Yep.
It's an interesting strategy, Cotton. Let's see how it plays out for him.
Yeah. Give me that corner kick. Here we go. So I'm continuing the trend here of audiobooks I listen to on this journey across America. And
we're coming to America.
That's right. That's the place. and this is an author who I've always been interested in, never found time to pick up because his books look so damn big. And that's Tom Clancy. I started with the classic that started the video game series, Rainbow Six. And because it's such a damn long book, I'm only 50% of the way through it. So I normally like to save my handles till I'm done with them, but I'm trying to get a thing going here with get the books out back to back. Bit of a, what do you call it? Trigger warning. There's one of the bad thing that happens in the book is a deadly virus that's supposed to kill humanity. So this might not be the book for 2020 for you.
Right.
But it's also funny because it's written, it's like this big anti-terrorism task force written in a pre-9/11 world. So like the book starts with them stopping terrorists who are hijacking an airplane. And it's kind of like pretty funny that it's like they had no idea where the world was going to go. But that being said, Tom Clancy's a great author. It's a page turner or a chapter listener. Is that the equivalent of a page turner on audiobook?
A word listener.
Yeah. It's a tape turner if I had a tape deck. It's a CD spinner. But
it's a play button presser.
Yeah. It's like the action is enough to keep you wanting to keep listening to the next chapter. And it keeps moving. And even though it's like a 34-hour long book.
Yikes.
Yeah. And I'm 18 hours into it. I keep going back and hitting play. And I'm a fan. So Tom Clancy, Rainbow Six. Check it out on Libby, previous handle, or get the physical book from your real library or an ebook from Overcast, or be a sucker and pay money for it. Those are your options, I think. Two of those are free, one's not. Okay, I'm handing it off. Middle handle. Here we go. Tud.
All right. So my handle this week is something really cool that I got to do today, and it's called Secret Hopper. So you guys know what a secret shopper is, right?
Yeah, I'm aware. You basically, like, they pay you to go into stores and buy stuff.
Correct. Yeah. Or see how, like, the customer service is and ask certain questions and stuff like that. So I signed up for this company called Secret Hopper probably a couple years ago. And part of the deal with Secret Hopper is that you get offered to go to breweries where they tell you, like, you have to buy a flight and a pint and drink them. And then they reimburse you for the payment plus, you know, give you a little bit of extra for your time. And then you have to write up a review on the brewery. So today I got assigned to go to Back East and drink some beer. And then I would be reimbursed up to $20 for my time. So that's the reason I headed over to Back East Brewery on this, the Veterans Day 2020, where they had a peanut butter shot stout on tap. It was a really cool experience, and now I get to get reimbursed and I have to write a review of my time at Back East Brewery. So this is my second time I've been offered a brewery. The first time I missed out on the first one. So this is officially marks the first day that I've gone out and secret hopped a local brewery.
That's, I mean, free beer. Not, right. Not free beer. They're paying you to drink beer.
Yeah.
Correct.
That's awesome. I'm gonna look this up.
That's the dream.
Yeah, that is literally the dream.
I know for a fact this wasn't a handout, because if it was, we would both have already signed up by now.
Exactly. That's exactly. Do you have like a, if you do you have a referral link or something? Refer Secret Hoppers. You should check it out. Well, because
I'm gonna check it out right now and see two referrals. If I do.
If there is one, it'll be in the show notes.
Exactly. Precisely right. That's correct. Awesome. That's a great idea. It's kind of like, well, not really, but what happened to that app? They shut down, right? The app that paid you to go to breweries or gave you money for checking in or whatever it was called. I don't even remember. It's like better. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, because this one actually pays you for your time.
Other than writing up a review, did you have to like go and look how clean the bathrooms were, or see how full the parking lot was, or like any hoops
they
want to jump through?
They want you to write like a detailed review of like the ambiance and the experience and how the beer was and how the staff was, but there's no real parameters besides, you know, go there and order a flight and a pint. I'm very curious to know about this one because Back East doesn't offer flights, so I had to try a couple different pints.
Tough work.
Yeah, it's very tough work. Somebody's got to do it though.
Got to put in overtime. Yeah.
So yeah. I'll bite that bullet for you guys, and I'll experience that for you.
Yeah.
Don't ever say I didn't do anything for you.
No, that's cool. It's funny that Back East came up twice tonight.
Right? Yeah. Well, yeah, he mentioned that he went there, but he didn't mention that he was getting paid for undercover work.
That's true. Yep, got paid.
Are you even allowed to tell us this?
I know, right?
I don't know.
Oh, God, I don't know.
Back East, you did good work.
I guess since it was good. If it was bad, I don't know if he'd tell us.
That's true.
Yeah, is it? I think I'm not positive, but I think the rules on like secret shoppers is like if you let anybody find out who you are, then like the you've broken the code of secret shopping, and the other secret shoppers legally have to hunt you down and kill you.
Oh well, good thing this is not secret shopping. This is secret hopping.
That's.
I think
it's a good
point. Even worse. To be honest, I think I've heard. I think I've heard shit. Worse than that. They make you wish you were dead.
Yeah. They hop over you.
All right, everybody, hop!
And so, I guess that's it. So I'm going to hand the mug over to Chris.
Take it away with our third and final period quarter.
Our third quarter, which is, of course, the last one.
Yeah.
We're
in overtime
now,
at the end of regulation.
It's the final set. So my handle this week is something that will... I mean, it's a good idea that I think everybody should look into. And I don't know. I know North Carolina does it. I don't know if every state does it. But there's an app available that I have that's called Slow COVID NC. And essentially what this does is the more people that download it, the better. And it constantly tracks where you are, GPS, things like that. I know like European nations, I think, have things close to this. Already in intact, but of course in the United States we don't think COVID's real, et cetera, et cetera. This is an app where it'll track where you're going, and you can go in and share whether or not you have a positive result, a positive COVID result. And if you do, you'll actually get an alert that says you were within X amount of feet in the same building, whatever, of someone that was positive for COVID. So it's kind of cool. I mean, it hasn't popped up for me yet, which is good, I guess. But I think we need to get more people on board with things like this, only because, I mean, everybody's spiking again. Everything's being bad. Like, let's make 2021 good. Let's do it.
So to clarify, if like Tud and you both have the app,
mm-hmm.
and you walked by each other on the sidewalk, and Tud put in his app, hey, I tested positive for COVID, you would get the alert that you were next to somebody who had COVID?
I don't know about walking on the street, but like if we were at the same restaurant, it would. I think.
You had to be in the same spot for a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
But only within North Carolina as well, I believe.
Well, this particular one is North Carolina, yes. But if North Carolina has an app, I almost guarantee that other states have apps because
Yeah, I'm sure. I'm sure. I know. I was actually looking at the cases in Connecticut today because I like punishment on myself, and I saw they have an app as well. So I know Connecticut has an app.
What if I don't want the man tracking me?
Montana's too worried about the man tracking them, so I don't think they have.
That's what I'm saying. Like, what if I don't want the man tracking me? Does anyone just have to move to Montana then?
I'm just telling. Every time you send a text message, the man is tracking you. Just get used to it. They know where we
are. Don't worry. I don't do that more than like 200-300 times a day.
They know where we are. Don't worry. If I was that concerned about the man tracking me, then I'd have bigger problems, I think.
You wouldn't have a cell phone.
Also true, yes. But I think, I don't know, I've heard stories that some European nations have things like that, and you actually, like, check in at restaurants and stuff like that. And I don't know. It's kind of cool. But, you know.
Chris does love checking in.
I do love checking in. That's true. It's one thing I do.
Do you remember your first check-in?
I remember my first check-in.
I don't remember mine. So just do a little bit of research, check it out, and see if you have a slow COVID app or something along those lines so you can be notified. You know, you don't want to be sick. No one wants to be sick. But more importantly, you don't want to get anybody else sick. I don't know. 2020 sucks. It's the worst.
Yeah. Do it for Alex.
Do it.
Do it for Sean Connery.
Do it for Alex and Sean. Yes. They're battling at the gates of heaven.
Only you can let them in by downloading Slow COVID NC, no matter where you live.
Yeah, download.
Chris wants to make sure that North Carolina is really safe. So even if you live in Washington State, you download that app now.
That's right.
And so with that, we'd like to thank you all for listening. We'd like to thank the breweries who provided today's beers. I will go first with thanking Skygazer for their I Remember My First Check-In. I guess I will also give a special shout-out to Untappd and Dogfish Head.
I would like to thank Back East Brewing for their double scoop.
And I'm going to thank Half Acre Beer Co. for their Orin.
Please make sure you head over to social media and follow us on every social media platform at DAWF Podcast. Also, make sure you hashtag follow the email at DAWFpodcast@gmail.com. Send us your thoughts, your questions, your comments, your concerns, any random thought you may have. Also, make sure you head over to Discord and join our Discord there to join in live conversation with real live people who listen to this podcast just like you. Please make sure you head over to iTunes and leave a 5-star rating as well as a comment. And also make sure you're sharing this podcast with your friends. Do it now. Also, make sure that you thank every brewery that you ever drink because they're all brewing Drinking Alone with Friends Memorial Beers. Brewer's choice of name, brewer's choice of ingredients. So make sure you're doing that, and make sure when you're stopping at your breweries, you tell them, thank you for brewing a beer just for Drinking Alone with Friends. I'm sure they will gladly appreciate that with you and for you noticing. And if there's nothing else from the two other folks.
I want to give a quick shout out. And by shout out, I mean quick boo of Blevin, who said that you can make pumpkin ravioli in the Discord after last week's call to arms. So you got to, there's other stuff from the episodes you want to discuss. You got to come up with better than pumpkin ravioli, Blevin. Come on.
Boo, Blevin.
Yeah, I mean, Blevin, really? And so with that, my name's Tud.
My name's Chris.
And I'm Obert. And remember, if you're drinking alone, do it with friends. I gotta watch some James Bond movies.
I know, right? So sad.
Dr. No.
I can't believe it's... You know what? I was so hungover after my beer pong that I missed the news completely.
No, no, he died on Halloween.
Yeah. But at first, I was like, fuck the shit, I'm out.
Ooh, you want to hear it again?
No, I've got it. I got the song. I got it all.